Irish people 75 years ago, and now Gay Byrne and Terry Wogan are among those reflecting affectionately on the history of radio in Ireland.
What would you say to me now if I tell you that I just don't understand?
Hello there.
The chief items of tonight's news.
The great European powers are again at war.
Thank God it's Friday, I hear you saying.
Radio Air. It took 115 years to make this trip. And three generations.
Hello, everybody. We have just been joined by Europe.
Hello there, and a very good morning to you.
This is Morning Ireland with David Hamilton.
It's 9 o'clock.
The right line is open at 18:57.
Good night, you all.
Good night.
There was a time when Ireland couldn't talk to Ireland, when accents and dialects were seldom heard outside their own district. There was no real national community, and the idea of national dialogue was unthinkable. Then, radio came. The story of radio's arrival is intensely political. It began with high aspirations, but also with rancor, scandal, and suicide. In the early 1900s, the Marconi Company set up powerful stations in Clifton and Ballybunion to compete with the transatlantic cable companies.
Hello, Canada. Hello, Canada. This is Ballybunion Island calling on 4100 meters. Please respond. Hello, Canada. Hello, Canada. This is Ballybunion.
These stations transmitted the first radio messages from Europe to America. The Marconi transmitters didn't survive the Civil War, but the connection between radio and politics had been made by the leaders of the Easter Rising. They broadcast news of the Rising from a transmitter smuggled into the GPO. Nobody heard the transmission, but it was a far-seeing idea. Broadcasting speech and music started at the beginning of the 1920s, but not in Ireland. We had no time to set up transmitters. We were engaged in a bitter civil war, but people were buying radios, so the architects of the new state faced a problem.
The London station of the British Broadcasting Company calling.
What do you do if you're in government in those circumstances? The BBC has got going a few years before. British influence can seep back over Ireland, if you like, culturally and intellectually, after it has been evicted militarily. So, partly in terms of national self-respect that any modern nation ought to have a radio station, because this is the cutting edge of the new technological communications means. So I think all these impulses and motives are fusing together in their minds as to why we must have some radio station.
There was a lot of debate about broadcasting. Proposals were drafted and memos were written. In fact, the amount of words devoted to the topic was amazing, considering Ireland was in bits after the War of Independence and the Civil War, and there was a huge job of physical reconstruction to be done. Buildings were in ruins, roads and railways out of commission, and the new state had a costly and difficult job on its hands. All the ambitious broadcasting proposals ended up on the desk of J.J. Walsh, Postmaster General of the Irish Free State. He was a man under pressure with very few resources at his disposal.
Walsh fought every inch of the way to try and scupper the thing. He simply didn't want to have it inside his department.
So the idea of a commercial, not a state radio service began to emerge. And this is where Daryl Figgis comes in. He'd been a literary gent in London's Bloomsbury set when he met Roger Casement, who introduced him to the cause of Irish freedom and Figgis sourced the guns that Erskine Childers smuggled into Hoth in 1914. He was soon a leading member of Sinn Féin.
He was the chairman of the committee set up to write the Constitution of the Irish Free State, and in 1922 he stood as an independent candidate and topped the poll for South Dublin with 15,000 votes.
Deputy Figgis proposed in the Dáil that a committee should be set up to consider the matter of wireless broadcasting. He became a member of that committee, and the main thing it had to decide was whether to award a broadcasting licence to a company headed by a man called Andrew Belton.
Figgis discovers that Belton is the leading promoter of a company which is going to set up a broadcasting station in Ireland. Figgis, in the Dáil, stood up and demanded a public inquiry into this. And the result was what we would now call a tribunal. It's ironic in a way that the tribunals at the moment are to do with payments to politicians for things like broadcasting licenses, because that is precisely what happened in 1924.
Free man's journal, read all about it. Minister takes bribes, read all about it.
I utterly refute these allegations. The man's a crook.
The whole thing backfired for Figgis when it came out that he'd accepted money from Belton for such things as election expenses, and that Belton probably expected favours in return. The newspapers latched onto the story, and the affair became a huge public scandal.
The Postmaster General was advocating the setting up of an Irish broadcasting company, of which the principal member would be Andrew Belton. And it was Figgis's knowledge of Belton as, to be blunt about it, a crook, which made him blow the whistle on the whole thing, and ironically led to his own public disgrace.
The story of Darrell Figgis TD has a tragic ending. His wife was unable to cope with the scandal. She went up into the Dublin Mountains, took out a revolver that Michael Collins had given her for her personal protection, and shot herself. Figgis himself went back to London, but also ended up taking his own life. His legacy was an ongoing debate about broadcasting.
The committee rejected the white paper of the Postmaster General, J.J. Walsh, and instead said that the thing should be in state ownership and under state control. And that, as everyone knows, is the way Radio Éireann was run for the first 40 years of its life.
Douglas Hyde, founder of the Gaelic League and later the first president of Ireland, spoke of the birth of a new national voice when he opened the station on January the 1st, 1926.
He was chosen simply because this was the beginnings of an Irish voice to be heard throughout the world, in which Irish culture and Irish affairs would have the principal place.
The station had the call sign 2RN, which was a pun on Erin, and Minister J.J. Walsh had firm ideas about its programme content.
The ordinary people of Ireland want amusement through broadcasting. They want nothing else, and they shall have nothing else.
The man eventually chosen as station director was a civil servant called Seamus Clandillon. He and his wife were traditional musicians, and at the start, 2RN was principally an Irish music station. This is how the first night sounded. This was not Irish music as we know it. It was a sort of Edwardian drawing room traditional music. Music, but no talk.
So let's put ourselves in their position. If it's going to do more than entertain, then it has to take positions on things. There are viewpoints, there's conflict, there's controversy. Now, they'd had a civil war 2 to 3 years before. They'd had enough conflict and controversy from their point of view when the whole objective was the stability of the state and the soundness of the fiscal system and everything like that. So stability took priority over virtually everything else, I would say.
seat. The muzzle then blinded me.
Mum, dear, did you never hear?
And slowly the wireless began to penetrate the social fabric of rural Ireland.
I'll never be a man again. Not a spot on me hide will. A
very swanky gentleman arrived in our village one evening and he sold one of these radio sets to a local shopkeeper. He put a ladder up to the roof of the house, got a roof ladder that was lying in that yard to the business premises, went up and stuck an aerial on top of the chimney. And a lead was from brought down from that right across the road to the house the other side. So we had wireless in the village.
You must remember in 1926, a minimum of Irish people would go on holidays. I mean, people didn't have the money to go on holidays for start off. So that it was common to see letters in the paper where people expressed astonishment. Let's say a Kerry man listened to a Calvin accent, first of all. He'd never heard that before. For most people, the cost of a wireless set of the valve type that would have used batteries, or indeed mains, would have been prohibitive. But the set that most could afford were called crystal sets. These were simple little sets that where you couldn't demand a station by tuning to it. You got what was coming in at that time and you had to listen to it, whether it was in French or anything else.
Il considère qu'en raison de sa durée et de son intensité, la crise des valeurs parmi les dirigeants et son...
And there was one unusual letter in the papers where at one part of the country there was a description of how to make a curragh. And I saw in one of the archive papers somebody else pleading with him not to continue, they'd surely get drowned. And the editor of the paper says, please note they have been making these for about 200 years, you know.
Pádraig Ó Maidhreanna was a regular performer on 2RN from 1926 to 1932. He was interviewed when he was 101 years of age.
So when my time came, I went in and saw the microphone. And when I think of modern phones, I have to laugh. In front of me was a frame, a hefty wooden frame, just exactly like the country frame that carried the end-over-end churn. So the green light came on. The place to me was like a shed. The walls and ceiling, they were draped with heavy curtains. I thought at the time it was just to stop echoes. In one corner was a very, very old lady, wrinkled, sitting on a chair. She didn't speak, I didn't speak to her, I just saw her. So I started and did my party piece anyway, and the red light came on and I turned and the old lady smiled at me and I smiled at her. And that was my first adventure.
The attitude was, I think, that only people trained professionally should be allowed broadcast. To bring a Shannon singer and bring him the whole way from wherever, from Kerry or someplace like that, and put him in front of a microphone in a studio, wouldn't have worked that well. So you didn't, and I think also that there was a certain amount of snobbery in relation to music, that only trained musicians, only trained violinists rather than fiddlers could play. And so you didn't get that wealth that we have now grown so accustomed to.
It became a sort of derriere to have an accompaniment. And I said, you don't want an accompaniment to a traditional song. It's not supposed to have one. But they insisted.
We had to be respectable, and we had to have orchestras, and we had to be as good as anybody else. We had to wear top hats at ceremonies. And that attitude would have been generally there.
But the Department of Finance thought the idea of wireless broadcasting was rather frivolous, so they kept 2RN under-resourced and understaffed, without even a recording machine. This official neglect was to continue for decades.
Broadcasting itself was the poor relation. Sean Lemass, at one stage, said to Paddy Little, who was a very good minister for broadcasting, how's the hurdy-gurdy, meaning, how's that broadcasting station of yours which you spend so much unnecessary time, you know, looking after? That was the contemptuous terms in which people referred to the broadcasting service at a certain time.
The Department of Finance had a simple rule, block expenditure. No initiatives, if at all possible, because initiative costs money. So the radio station was in fact starved of anything like remotely adequate funding for an ambitious series of programmes.
There was also a problem because it was almost impossible to receive 2RN in Cork, the minister's own constituency. Eventually, the tight-fisted Department of Finance agreed to a second station in the southern capital. But to save money, it was situated in the disused female prison in Sunday's Well. Ironically, the station's first director, Sean Neeson, had done time in the jail, courtesy of the British.
Because of the limitation of the finance, they actually used a prison which had no longer been in use in Cork, and that cut down on the cost there. They put everything in there, both the studios and the transmitter tower outside. And it opened on the 25th of April 1927.
The main output focused on Sunday evenings, and a concert was broadcast, and the music in these concerts and the musicians were certainly first class. Sean brought artists from London, and there were many distinguished musicians locally who also participated. The government of the day didn't consider it was worth the money to run it, that it was spending on it, a mere £1,000 a year. And so the last broadcast took place September 1930, and the programme staff were let go.
In the early 1930s, when De Valera was waging his economic war with Britain, 2RN remained silent on the issues of the day. The new state was becoming isolated, introverted and conservative. Church and state had formed a close alliance, and the Gaelic League had become a powerful force in the land. It turned its attention to broadcasting.
They started to come down heavily on 2RN for not having enough Irish, and in fact went as far as to say like that it was something of a machine for anglicising the people. People weren't willing to listen to that much Irish, perhaps, at that time. Lots of people had only recently, it was only those who had recently gone to school who knew Irish, I mean, since 1921. So a great deal of the population wouldn't have had Irish. And I think, as Ricardo Farrakhan used to say, it's not so much the amount of Irish you broadcast is significant, but the amount that people are willing to listen to.
So we listened to 42 plays in the Irish language in 1 year, but we heard none of The Devil's Music.
I never liked what she likes. That's my weakness now.
People heard things in jazz that we wouldn't have heard, that we wouldn't now hear at all. They heard, as they would have described it, something coming from the jungle. Which wasn't Irish. And so there was that attitude. And I suppose a great deal of the people who were against jazz had never heard jazz.
Young teachers should be trained for the teaching of Irish music and dancing. And the government should compel the closing of dance halls at 11 o'clock. I appeal to political parties to give up their disputes and unite on this question and put down this jazz.
3,000 South Leitrim farmers march against jazz. How many of them would have knew what they were marching against at all? Both the words and the music were not quite what people had in mind for Radio Éireann, perhaps.
The Eucharistic Congress was announced for 1932. 2RN badly needed a high-power transmitter in Athlone to give it national coverage. Suddenly, the authorities found the resources to broadcast to the nation and the world.
The Eucharistic Congress is very important from the state's point of view, obviously from the church's point of view, but for the state it is the first great unifying bond between the two sides of the Civil War. This was something they both believed passionately in. they are desperately looking around for ways of literally binding up the wounds of the Civil War, and the Eucharistic Congress is literally a godsend from that point of view. And they use it very effectively. And it also gives people, not just ideologically, but geographically, a sense of a united Ireland.
It was all done at the last minute. In fact, the building housing the Marconi transmitter wasn't even finished in time.
The roof wasn't on the building, and high tension or any type of radio transmitter involves high tension, and that is a situation where you can't have dampness, not to mention perhaps rain coming in. Well, they realised this, efforts were made maybe to speed it up in terms of the roof, but that wasn't going to be, and tarpaulins were eventually implied just to protect the transmitter. Now, it could have destroyed the transmitter, and the earnest clergy appealed to the people to pray for fine weather for the success of the Congress itself, because a lot of people would be outdoors and all that. And the post office engineers and Marconis got down on their knees and they prayed hard that it would stay dry also, but for their transmitter.
The chief items of tonight's news are British relations with Germany, French flying boat leaves Foynes.
Geraldine Plunkett was an announcer. Dev didn't like women reading his speeches, but one evening there was no male announcer available and she had to do it. Afterwards, she made a nervous phone call to get his reaction.
Statement on lost submarine.
When he came on, I said, knowing how you feel about women announcers reading your statement, I just wanted to know if you were happy with my work. He said, Miss Plunkett, if my delivery in the Senate were half as good as yours over the air, I'd be very well satisfied. Well, at that I just shook. It was wonderful. It was very big of him, very nice of him, and it certainly gave me great satisfaction.
I mean, even in 1927, after De Valera had taken his seat in the Dáil, he made a broadcast on Radio Éireann, and the next day the Irish Times carried a report of it with the headline, Politics by Wireless. And I think at that crucial point, the connection was made between current affairs and radio. The Second World War being, of course, the most obvious and the most intense period in which this country maintained some kind of knowledge and awareness of what was going on in the outside world by the medium of radio, because press reports, of course, were very heavily censored.
The Nazis, in their rise to power, had perfected the use of broadcasting in politics. Winston Churchill was quick to copy Hitler's example. De Valera, aware of what was happening, also learned the power of the radio broadcast.
De Valera is trying to protect the state from what he sees as a dual threat. And the dual threat isn't just German and British. They're all one threat as far as he's concerned. There's also the IRA threat internally. And so his radio speeches, they're sermons, really. They're sermons to mobilise people in the one true faith of the national interest above all others.
The most likely way to come near to meeting our requirements is to get all former producers of turf to double their output.
We should all realise that whilst this war lasts, there can be no security. Our thoughts should go out in sympathy to the millions of our fellow beings.
A land whose countryside would be bright with cosy homesteads, whose fields and villages would be joyous with the sounds of industry, with the romping of sturdy children, the contests of athletic youths, and the laughter of happy maidens.
But James Dillon, opposition leader, was convinced that De Valera's use of radio was not for the good of the nation, but for the good of Fianna Fáil.
I met James Dillon socially, and he said to me, Miss Plunkett, I've hated you for years. And I said, really? What did I do to deserve that? He said, you made that man sound like the guardian angel of his people. This was Dev. He thought I made him sound too good.
Atlantic convoys entering the high danger zone island often pay a terrible price for the centuries-old Anglo-Irish quarrel. Error remaining in...
De Valera's problem was that the country was being deluged by this sort of wartime British propaganda.
Speaking from Dublin, with such popularity as makes him virtually a dictator, not only in the Doyle but throughout the country, Prime Minister De Valera is unmoved by British persuasion. Since he has been in power, the peasants are with him to a man. This very green and lovely land breeds a race as different from the English as Englishmen differ from Italians. Most of Era's 3 millions rest from the soil, a living which would be poverty this side the Irish Sea. But unlike the English, they do not generally want more than they have. In many ways, the Irish peasants, sharing their cottage with the pig, living on potatoes, are freer than the English artisan.
Long before the term was fashionable, De Valera was a diaspora tinker. And one can see in his radio broadcasts, his St. Patrick's Day broadcasts over the years, which are specifically aimed at the Irish abroad as well as the Irish at home. He's always addressing na Gaeilge Thar Lár, as well as those here at home. And he's very conscious of its potential. He's also conscious, you see, of the continuing British diplomatic and cultural pressure. And you never know when you might need to try to mobilise diaspora opinion, particularly in America, as a counterweight to British pressure on Ireland. That's always at the back of his mind.
Era, with its population of little more than 3 millions, not only turns a blind eye and a deaf ear to the World War, but is apparently indifferent to what might happen to her if the Germans won. Only by sea can the widespread forces of the Grand Alliance communicate.
Anything
with each
Ireland
other.
Broadcast in the response on our weak transmitters was picked up by the British and heavily censored before being retransmitted. We needed our own opinions to be heard.
And in order to address those, you had to have the shortwave. You had to be abreast of the latest technology that would carry the message. So he was an enthusiast for shortwave development, and after the war was in fact prepared to put substantial resources into it.
The case for a shortwave transmitter to broadcast to the world was hotly debated in the Doyle.
Shortwave radio will let the world know that we are a progressive young nation.
The whole thing is just a cod designed to perpetuate the myth that Eamon de Valera is the greatest man that ever lived, a view that most of us do not hold.
The peoples of the world need to hear our views.
Nobody from Singapore to Southampton gives a hoot about our views. 5 years from now, the shortwave masts will be taken down and used as knitting needles.
The transmitter was ordered, but Dev lost power.
And then it was chopped by the incoming inter-party government. And I don't think that there were many people at that time shared De Valera's vision of Ireland as part of a wider world.
35,000 people crowd New York's polo ground. A great day, Irish. Bands playing and thousands of enthusiastic Irish-Americans...
From the very early days, sport figured in the radio schedules. In fact, Irish radio is credited with having broadcast the first live commentary of a sporting event on this side of the Atlantic. It was an All-Ireland hurling semi-final between Kilkenny and Galway in 1926. It marked the start of a national institution.
Mair O'Dwyer throws in the ball and the game is on. Kavanagh first to attack, but Kerry settled down better in the early stages, and after a short bout in the defence, they go into the attack. Paddy Kennedy catches a nice one. He sends it across the goal mouth. Garvey is in position...
He gave the impression that he was talking to you all the time, and he had all these phrases that he used, and he personalised the game.
...of the game.
Up to that point, the commentator gave you the facts of what was happening, but he didn't perform. I think what O'Hare did was to bring in performance into it.
Kerry followers smiled. Later they laughed, but as the hour went on, the story changed.
But in terms of the listener, he always tried to keep the listener listening by persuading him that the match was either A, better than it was, or the team they were supporting had a better chance than they had.
Can Mayo catch Cavan? Can Mayo take the lead? Can Cavan prove themselves the champions that they undoubtedly are by staying out there in front.
Radio played a part through sports broadcasting, and above all through the voice of Micheál O'Hare. Seamus Heaney talks about fellas climbing on the backs of chairs to listen to the wireless, etc. I think it was many a fella, young lad and older lad, who sort of did bodily harm to chairs in the 1950s, listening to Micheál O'Hare's voice, which was a unifying voice throughout the country. If there was an Irish voice, it was Micheál O'Hare's.
A clearance by Johan paves the way for a Garvey solo and yet another Kerry goal.
Sport proved to be nearly as controversial an arena as politics. At the end of 1937, 2RM became Radio Éireann, and relationships between it and the GAA were complex. Both organisations believed they were responsible for the success of the other, and this led to clashes.
They decided that they were going to cover the two All-Ireland, or the two Railway Cup matches. But they also decided that they were going to give coverage during half-time in the hurling match to the Scottish League and Irish League match in Dalymount Park. And as soon as the GAA heard that, there was uproar. And one of their presidents accused RTE of undermining Irish culture and Irish tradition by putting out all these foreign games on Patrick's Day or Patron Saints. It was all that sort of stuff.
But the Minister for Defence, Oscar Traynor, was a veteran of the War of Independence and also the president of the Football Association of Ireland. He didn't like the suggestion that his love of soccer made him some sort of second-class Irishman.
For a time, Cork besieged Dundalk's goal and forced three corners in succession. But Dundalk held on to their lead.
And there was a fierce row about it, and it ended up with the match had not been covered. RTE's function, as any broadcaster's function, is to give as broad a coverage as possible, being conscious of the importance of big organisations, but not locked into believing that they're the only ones that exist, whereas the organisations themselves sometimes give the impression that that's the case.
Even music became controversial. Radio Éireann had by this time developed a substantial orchestra, but there was a notion that its repertoire had to be politically correct.
Classical music was associated with the Anglo-Irish. It was associated with organisations like the RDS, for example. And therefore, as a minority pursuit, it was always going to be put down by people who were trying to go along the main tracks of Reconstruction, Renaissance, whatever.
The debate about whether it was patriotic to listen to classical music and to invite in foreigners to play it took up a surprising amount of time in the Dáil.
I would prefer no orchestra to employing aliens. It's disgraceful bringing foreigners into Ireland against the wishes of the Irish people.
The plain people of Ireland prefer ballads to symphonies.
The orchestra is just for the benefit of a few old fogies in that mind.
There were players from behind what used to be called the Iron Curtain. I remember one selection panel querying the appointment of one player, horn player from Yugoslavia, because they wanted to know more about his politics than his ability to play the horn. As early as 1927, Vincent O'Brien realized that he should bring the orchestra out of the studio into the marketplace, so to speak. And this tradition of public live concert giving has gone on right up to the present day.
I am a roving journeyman, I go from town to town. Where'er I get a job or work, I'm willing to sit down. Me bundle on me shoulder.
Today, Mr. A.P. Herbert, independent member for Oxford, ask the Dominion Secretary...
And at the end of the day, the traditional 2RN fare still remained the backbone of the Radio Éireann schedules.
Now there's a bridge below the town, I'd hand you all to know. Tis broken and it's crumbling to the ground. But there we used to gather...
The year of our Lord, 137.
my time is spent, and now I go on my way.
Have you ever been in love, me boys, or have you felt the pain? I'd sooner be in jail myself than be in love again.
They knew the names of all the people who put on programs or compared them. I heard some nice stories, like a boy running out and calling, if, come on, Dad, she's on. And maybe reading the news or something. That kind of thing just made life pleasant.
In the mid-40s, Irish radio was still a force for restraining change rather than accelerating it. But this comforting reality was on the way out. Erskine Childers, whose father was executed in the Civil War, was now the minister responsible for broadcasting. He introduced a new era.
Erskine Childers, who had more cause than many to remember the horrors of the Civil War, in a sense, passed a vote of confidence in the coming generation, and maybe even his own. He was a bit younger than Dev himself and then Cosgrave and so on, that no, we can now discuss things without having to have every word scripted, because we can begin to be confident that everything will not return to whose side were you on then.
...1948 is a crucial year. As the last trams disappear from Dublin, Radio Éireann acquires a new tool, one that is to transform broadcasting, the mobile recording unit. With it come some new faces.
Production of programmes was given a new kind of status, a new kind of professionalism. In fact, it was then, I suppose, and I've said this elsewhere, that it was then that you could begin to think of broadcasting as a job, as a career.
Sean McRaymond's accomplice was the piper Seamus Ennis.
When Seamus Ennis, my colleague and myself, were appointed to the job of outside broadcast officer, so-called, what we really were doing was mobile recording. Instead of bringing people to the microphone, we brought the microphone to them. And this was a very important development.
Hello, my honest neighbour. You're welcome into any old farmstead in Tipperary at any hour of the night.
Thank you very much.
I happen to be the proprietor of this house. My name is Patsy Fagan from Ballinamona. Anyhow, that's your name, sir.
My name is Seamus Ennis.
Pleased to meet you, Seamus Ennis. You're quite welcome into the old-fashioned dance.
Thank you very much.
What's the name of God is that whole thing you have there in your hand? The name of God is...
It's a microphone.
Well, to
a
the music policy, it certainly meant that for the first time, there was the beginnings of an archive. They went down, I think one of the first places was Leitrim and then to Slievelochra. And all of that material became very valuable in later years.
People all over the island of Ireland were made aware that other parts of the country shared with them this music.
Some years previously, the radio service had moved from its original home in Little Denmark Street to the GPO. Things were beginning to look up for the production people. There was greater independence and more resources. But there was a darker side as well. Official Ireland was still very conservative, and censorship was a daily reality in the neoclassical corridors of Radio Éireann. Issues like the post-war depression and massive emigration were rarely aired. There were new talents on the scene, but not all of them were welcome in the GPO.
Radio Éireann and anybody in power was part of official Ireland. I didn't challenge censorship, or most people of the time thought it was a joke, in a way that there was a fairly vigorous underground society that paid scant regard to church or state and thought for ourselves. We saw no possibility of change and weren't interested in change, but I think it wasn't a bad thing.
It wasn't so much that there was censorship. There was a much more dangerous thing, perhaps, self-censorship. That's always a danger in any society where it is known, where the fact of censorship is something we know about. And that's self-censorship, where you don't take the risks. That's a danger. That is very much a danger. And perhaps we were all guilty of that at various times.
State control of public broadcasting, even in the post-war period, I'm not talking about Hitler's Germany, was quite widespread in Western Europe. There was an assumption that radio and television subsequently, in many countries, would toe an official line.
But issues like this occurred principally in urban Ireland, and the country was still largely rural. Rural Ireland, for the most part, didn't yet have the ESB.
The battery, of course, for those who were lucky enough to have the funds to provide themselves with a battery set, there was an ongoing requirement there to look after it and all that. Now, the high-tension battery usually was 120 volts. It had to be charged, again, dependent on the usage, of course. And its function was to heat the valves. For that, you had to go to the nearest town to get the battery charged. There was no rural electrification. And the only means, invariably, was a bicycle. And it was dangerous on a frosty morning. I've seen people fall and batteries and bits and all that sort of thing. So that was a very important part of the wireless itself. I have no doubt at all that the word wireless was associated with the battery sets. When in towns, they tended to call the wireless the radio sooner than did country people. But I did some checking on it, and invariably, where country people changed from wireless to radio, it coincides with the coming of rural electrification.
In that sense, that it affected Ireland and affected radio, it opened up the world, I suppose, in a particular kind of way. There was no longer rural darkness and all of those things that belonged to a different era.
And, of course, the next great technological innovation was the transistor and portable radios. How our lives were changing.
Bluebird singing a song. Nothing but blue.
It's Thursday afternoon.
There was more speech on the radio nowadays, but it wasn't features of current affairs. Most of it came from the radio drama department.
Yes, Mr. Shaw. No trouble at all, Mr. Shaw. But I don't think I'd be able to send them up to you right away.
The word REP was actor's shorthand for repertory theatre, but in Ireland, it was an acronym for the Radio Éireann Players.
Yeah, I mean, the Foley family was like Dynasty. People would talk about it on the bus the next day, the latest exploits of Tom and Alice Foley. Very simple idea of just about a Dublin family and the things that happened to them. The workload in the REP was extraordinary. I mean, we would do the Sunday play, we would do the children's serial, we would read the short story on Sunday morning.
It wasn't all radio soap operas. Some of it was high drama, and some of it was so high you could smell it before you heard it.
Blow in and crack your cheeks. Rain, blow. You cataracts and hurricanes.
I have lost my own people by you and by your druid bonds, Gráinne, and the friends of my heart, and the men that used to hunt with me and fight with me and play with me. I have lost the peace of the...
I think it's totally unique from the point of view of the listener, performer relationship, because in radio, all you have is the sound. And if you have good actors acting, they can create a whole world. But the interesting thing for the listener is that they have their own individual performance, because they decide what the actor looks like, what the character looks like. They decide on the colors, they decide on the costumes, they do everything. So it's a wonderful creative process.
This is Paddy Crosby after turning another corner and finding another school. The Mead Street School boasts of its boxing.
Player got along the channel, the path.
And what do you call that?
So after one another.
After one another.
Once upon a time, there was a young star named Spink who lived up in the sky with all the other stars.
Glunto, glunto, call na beep. In the creaker, quick she shock. A drum cussa, rinchori. Creaker, quick she shock.
Radio Erin. Good morning.
And here is the news.
Ladies and gentlemen, once again, we invite you to lift the latch, open the door, step right in and take the floor.
Commercial pressures and sponsored programs had been slow to take hold in Irish radio, but now they began to exercise their muscle, and this led to some tension in the schedules.
I got a call from Radio Erin saying would I like to come in and see them, and they offered me a show called Happy Days Are Here Again. And a little seaside type of thing, you know, with piano playing and that, did a real jolly. But the thing was, we finished the late Mr. Austin Clark's poetry program. Now, remember, we had to start off with Happy Days Are Here Again, you see. But then we were following this poem that was going on. And they followed his coffin down the old bog road. And we're all waiting for Happy Days Are Here. It wasn't too easy.
Don't let the stars get in your eyes. Don't let the moon break your heart. Love blooms at night, in daylight it dies.
There were two traditions existing in Radio Erin at this time: the new commercial ethos of Roy Croft and the 2RN tradition personified by Seamus Ennis.
And I remember a man named Pat Cannon of Ardmore, Carnan. He was a lovely flute player, and he took to the pipes afterwards. Some of his family are playing now. I met him one day on the road.
So what happened when Roy lost his records one night and had to borrow from Seamus?
Charmaine, I wonder why.
Now I should have had Charmaine playing. Da da da, dee dee dum, dee dee. No Charmaine. But I had the red light and I said, "Good afternoon, listeners, and welcome to the Radio Review Show. Now this afternoon we're going to take you on a little trip round the country to hear people of their various tunes and songs." And I had the first one on. Now I said, "This one is Mr. Tighe, whatever his name was, from Ballin the House Your Father," and I played it. And I know that I didn't know. You never heard anything like it in your life. So while that's going on, I'm sweating blood, and it finishes. And while it's on, I say, "Seamus, have you anything else? Surely you might." "I have a lovely flute player," he said. So anyway, this was another Tighe, and we put him on. And this went on and on and on for the 15 minutes. And I, at this stage, I'm in bits, but I can't do anything about it. And so it comes to an end, and I say goodbye to everybody, and the phone rings, and the gentleman that owned the Radio Review was on to me and said, "What is happening?" Well, I said, the position was this. I said, "You know, the records, they break. I can tell you that, like, the records were all popular records. Now, we went into the country. We went down amongst the people, and we've had a phone call to say how much they enjoyed it. So, you know, Ireland is not Dublin. It's..." "Yes," he said, "yes, yes." "But it'll never happen again." And it didn't.
This is the Walton Programme, your weekly reminder of the grace and beauty that lie in our heritage of Irish song, the songs our fathers loved.
Nothing to worry about!
Did you feel that?
Yeah.
Did you go bump?
I went bump.
I went bump.
You went bump.
We both went bump.
We went bump.
That's all right, we just hit an air pocket.
Well, you shouldn't have written it, should you?
At all events, Woman's Page draws its material from the lives and events of real people. And it comes to you now with the compliments of Jacobs, the biscuit makers.
Two, one, kill 1962!
The sponsored programs introduced new sounds to the Irish airwaves. The times were about to change. And, from the point of view of the people working in radio, there was something terrifying on the horizon.
Ladies and gentlemen, both here in the Gresham and back behind that camera, these are the last moments of the first day of Telefiche Éireann. And if some of you have enjoyed some of it, then we're extremely happy.
So radio, on the one hand, is having greater opportunities from the opening up and also from technological advances, which allow much closer communication in a way between the broadcasters and the public. It has this new opportunity, but at the same time, is this all going to be snatched from it by the greater glamour of television in a way? So I think there's, in some ways, a crisis of confidence in radio in the 60s, even though many fine things are done. And it takes that decade for radio to find, in a way, a new niche for itself in the television age.
One very well-known and very distinguished person with considerable knowledge of the background said, look, you can take it that from now on, this was shortly after the start of the television series, that radio is simply television for the blind. You know? Well, it has proved itself to be something far more than that.
I didn't listen to radio, Aaron, because it was boring. I mean, it was all camellias, beating the old feet on the floor, fiddles and barons, and well-meaning talks, and an awful lot of Gaelic, which didn't really reflect the way the people were. Most people couldn't speak Irish. There were a few good things with the Kennedys of Castle Ross, and there was hospitals requests. I think that was about it.
People in the old GPO would have been of a certain disposition, not only Gaelic Gore, but they would have been literary people. And you have to remember that the GPO, Radio Éireann of the GPO, was a branch of the civil service at that time. So people found themselves seconded from other departments to go over and run this whirligig on a temporary basis. But they found themselves on a temporary basis there for 40 years.
Well, the squalor really was the first thing that hit you. Now, it was that long corridor. And when you'd be on in the early morning, and there wouldn't be a light on in the corridor, and then the far end, you'd just see the light of the main control room, and you'd go in there. It was a lonely life. You felt you were the only person alive, because in those days, long before the Celtic Tiger roared, Ireland didn't really wake up until about 10 o'clock. You couldn't get anything before about 10 o'clock in the morning. The streets of Dublin would be empty. You could park wherever you liked. Can't do that now, I'm perfectly certain. And you go in and you open up the microphone, try and desperately struggle to find out who the saint of the day was and what his name in Irish was. Athanasius. There's no real Irish equivalent for that. And then you'd welcome Dia Eva Corja Gael, and off you'd go. Sit in there playing a bit of uplifting music. And so the long day would wear on.
For student nurse Miriam Wall in Cork Regional Hospital, with lots of love from all the family.
The sun is out, the sky is blue, there's not a cloud to spoil the view, but it's rain.
Radio Éireann and the GPO, before we moved out here, probably felt themselves as the poor relation. And television was the glamour job. Television was the glamour business to be in, and poor old radio was being left behind. But they gradually picked themselves up and realised that, led by television, and probably compelled by television a good bit, they had to, as it were, get with it and start doing better.
The torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans.
The times really were a-changing. Radio Éireann was now RTE Radio. Pirates were abroad, and the national broadcaster was getting left behind. But it was retaliating, starting to try out some new things and looking for extended broadcasting hours. Current affairs programmes were becoming more important.
Now, for his analytical approach to current affairs, this award to Mr. Maurice McConaughey.
They brought in Maurice McAneill, who was then working on television as head of features and current affairs. And McAneill started to build what would be essentially a talk-based radio daytime schedule, something that we, in many ways, just did not have before.
My husband has those. I mean, he's wonderful, I must say that. When you get a wheelbarrow for your birthday... And your
daytime programmes brought a new kind of listener, the housewife.
Oh, that's always what I wanted. Thank you very much, dear. That's marvellous.
You got a wheelbarrow?
A wheelbarrow for my birthday.
For your birthday?
Absolutely. And I must say, I was moved by it. Ha-ha.
And it was quite extraordinary success. You must remember, there was nothing there before, so we were the only game in town. And there were no commercial stations, and television hadn't really taken hold. And so we started doing it, and it took off right from the word go. It was quite extraordinary. And whereas most other programmes, people complained that the presenter is talking too much, let's hear the music. We did play music, of course, on the Gay Byrne Show, but very quickly the complaints were, forget about the music, let's hear more talk.
Why did you need a new bed? You mean it had gone saggy and everything?
Yeah, saggy.
I see. And you were both rolling down into the middle.
That's right. How did you know?
It happens in the best marriages, Sarah. It does.
What I'm looking for is a nice, soft, bouncy double bed.
A nice, soft, bouncy double bed. Yes.
I think radio has always been sort of part of my life. I notice even now I go to sleep with the radio on. I like to wake up with the radio on. And I also discovered that people would ring me up and say, you must listen, I'm just hearing something. Are you listening to such and such? Which meant that there was a kind of a communality of radio experience as well.
I tried to have intercourse with my husband. I was a virgin. We were both virgins. And I found that I couldn't.
People started to talk about their problems on the air for the first time and write very long letters about their situation. People who are sitting in their own parlour, talking to you on the telephone, very often forget that they're actually going out on air. And so they started to tell me the most intimate details of their lives and their problems. And so we started to talk about all kinds of things which had never been talked about in public. Indeed, very often I thought they hadn't been talked about in polite company ever before. And certainly they hadn't been discussed ever before on the old Radio Éireann, which was a rather constrained, confined kind of place. And so we started uncovering all sorts of things about the society in which we lived.
One of the great traumas of the 80s was the death of the schoolgirl Anne Lovett in childbirth in a lonely graveyard in Longford.
So we hope you bear with us this morning while we read to you just a fraction of the letters that have come in on this subject.
Ennis. Teenagers all over Ireland should be on their knees, praying to what I believe is their new martyr, Anne Lovett. Let there be no doubt but that she died in the arms of Mary to save all other girls from ending their life like her.
Ballantyre, Dublin 16. What in God's name happened? Will we ever know? One thing is for certain, it should not be brushed under the carpet. We've done that too often.
I think of Gay Byrne not as he is now, but as the man who began, who facilitated Irish women to write basically to one another. They were writing to him.
But where does one lay the blame? Surely on a small-mindedness and limited attitude which, it has to be admitted, still prevails, particularly in the small-town situation where fear of poisoned tongues still reigns supreme.
I'm a native there were of wonderful myself, letters. So I know a whole, so to say, half the nation discovered a new way of articulating themselves.
Unmarried mothers in Ireland find it almost impossible to get on a local authority housing list, much less get a house.
You had that sense of being a pioneer. You had that sense of leading the nation's debate. You had that sense when you came in on a Monday of saying, what will the country talk about this week? And it was very, very exciting and a wonderful place to be.
Hello, a very good afternoon to you, and welcome to another edition of Women Today. So now, straight into today's programme, which is part one of a two-part programme on sex education.
I didn't really know anything. Nothing at all.
I had one lecture by a nun when we were in fifth and sixth year.
When Women Today started, it had a very radical agenda, and the group that worked on the first programmes were all committed to seeing women's progress and seeing the programme as part of that progress. We addressed issues like women working outside the home, the contraceptive issue. Contraception was still illegal, if you remember, in 1979. We addressed issues like women's sexual problems, which was seen as highly radical, women not being allowed into certain pubs and golf clubs. We got into a lot of trouble with that kind of material. But all of the time we were getting feedback from ordinary women by way of telephone.
Enforce the Constitution! Enforce the Constitution!
When, as I say, Betty Purcell and people like that began to get active, then I suppose there were much more obvious, louder arguments about whether things should or should not be treated for radio. But most of that contention was dealt with, most of that contention was focused on television.
The emphasis shifted from television back into radio at that time. And I believe that the reason for that was that for managements in RTE, who could be quite nervous about the kind of criticism they would get or the pressures that were put on them, there was a wonderful plausible deniability about radio discussions. No matter what was said, the management could always put their hands up and say, we didn't know the person was going to say that. Because it was open, it was free, those who would be opposed to it were disinclined to be seen to be trying to shut down public debate. But at the same time, I think they recognised that the day in which you could ring up the Director General and control something that was happening on radio was over.
Television is a very stilted medium in many ways, if I may say so. You have your invited guests. Right, and they're invited because it's assumed they're going to say certain things along certain lines. Once you open up radio like this to chat shows on the line, etc., now God knows off which left field they're coming or out of which left field they're coming, but you get a much wider range of perspectives. And even if you're saying, that's daft, at least you're listening to it. And there's a constituency for daftness as well.
The troubles were flaring up in the north, and RTE found that there were still some topics that were taboo.
These people were allowed to appear on television. They were being glamorized by the National Television Authority.
Section 31 was an obscure paragraph of the Broadcasting Act. It was invoked to prevent RTE interviewing people belonging to several named organizations, including Sinn Féin and the IRA. Journalist Kevin O'Kelly broadcast an RTE radio interview with Provisional Sinn Féin member Sean McStierfoyne. The government response was swift. The RTE authority was dismissed, and Kevin O'Kelly received a jail sentence, later reduced to a fine.
They breached the terms of reference given to them by Parliament. Parliament is the bulwark of democracy, not RTE.
It was a depressing atmosphere to work in. I remember at one stage, when I was only here in radio a couple of years, going into a meeting and suggesting we do a programme on the Birmingham Six, and there was just a dead silence in the room, and somebody muttered, that's a very dangerous topic.
The climate was such that even rebel songs, beloved by Radio Éireann, began to disappear from RTE radio.
There's much more scope, it seems to me, for debate, for controversy, for raising issues, for rebuttals on radio. And I think I would have liked to have seen Section 31 gone on radio, certainly much earlier.
And there was another kind of censorship. For the first time, revenue from commercials, as opposed to license fees or other forms of exchequer funding, accounted for the bulk of radio's income. And the commercial interests began to flex their muscles.
People who commanded the commercial world would from time to time get upset by what we were doing. And I remember at one stage we had a very effective and very popular shopping basket on the Gay Byrne show, which in fact was stopped by a combination of grocers' organisations and by IBEC, who came into RTE and carpeted me and carpeted the head of commercial affairs at the time and the controller of programmes of radio, and insisted that we take this off, and it was taken off. That was one of the most blatant and powerful pieces of censorship that I ever saw inside the organisation.
Good afternoon. Here's the Bangles from Sunshine Hot Hits 101 FM.
Competition from the pirates was increasing. A pop culture had developed and spread throughout the country, and RTE Radio was losing market share to it. But it was, rather slowly, developing its answer to the challenge. Radio Dublin!
In 1977, the captain and Inche Corr in a small, normal terraced house had a pirate station. Nobody listened to us. But one day the thing was raided, and then the whole thing was just huge. And then suddenly seven pirate stations, I think, sprung up around the country within the next 2 months. It's Radio 2! By the time pirates came along, it was pretty obvious there was something badly lacking. But it wasn't as though I found lights, that people were giving out to RTE for not doing it. It was just that there should have been an alternative.
Not the one with the pictures.
2FM then was going to start up. People said, supposedly, that Billy Waugh was going to be taken off the Gay Byrne show on the radio, and he's going to be made a big head of something new, which is called Pop Music Station, and they were going to bring it in maybe by 84, 85. Pirates became so quick, so fast, so big and so popular that they did it in May 1979. The winning sound
of Ireland. 2FM, or RT Radio 2 as it was called in the early days, was not the only answer that the station came up with when it was faced with the challenge of competition. It also started to develop local radio.
Is Cork Local Radio broadcasting on 240 metres medium wave.
The radio service had always been pressured by the language revival movement to broadcast more programmes in Irish. But now the language freedom movement and the advertisers were pressing for less Irish. And less Irish did mean more listeners. RTE's answer was to set up Radio na Gaeltachta and reduce the amount of Irish on its other radio channels.
Isn't Seo a Gasla a Gunamara a Tan Station? Tagan a Racht Regulier as na Kira Hardily Hele.
People would hear Irish regularly. Whether they were interested or not, they would hear something, and it helped them keep a grip on the amount of Irish they'd learned at school. In other words, it protected a huge investment by the state in the Irish language.
The pirate radio situation had got out of hand, and the government saw only one viable way out. They set up the Independent Radio and Television Commission to license and regulate commercial broadcasting. One of the IRTC's major goals was to license an independent national radio station in competition with RTE Radio. Century Radio was awarded the franchise and opened by Minister Ray Burke.
As I've said, RTE have a full range of services already available to them, and the services that have been announced today are complementary to the RTE services.
Attempts to curb RTE's income to allow for competition led to street demonstrations.
I believe that this bill is the most damaging, potentially the most damaging attack ever on RTE in the history of this state.
Century Radio eventually failed, but the IRTC and independent commercial radio were here to stay and would be very successful. But the rumours that had surrounded the issuing of radio licences, as in 1924, eventually led to judicial tribunals.
Commercial radio on the local level was inevitable. And it wasn't an antagonistic realisation either. I'm not sure how positively helpful RTE was going to be about it, or how concerned it had to be about it. Obviously, marketing, sales and marketing were going to be very concerned about it. But there wasn't any sense of great threat. There was a sense of development, and the development was a good thing.
Dublin's best way to get the day underway.
Saturdays from 6, only on Cork's 96 FM.
The radio audience is very different today to the audience of 1926. Radio is everywhere, in the traffic jam, in the ear of the jogger, in your face. And there's an almost infinite choice of stations.
FM Radio Kerry. Welcome to the 11 to 1 Club.
There are even more developments ahead. Digital technology will not only increase the choice, it'll also offer the chance to download material to let you make up your own listening schedules, and you'll be able to read the title of the music track you're listening to. This, for example, is an interface between your radio and your computer. Some believe that the mass audience will disappear and we'll be left with lots of niche markets. Challenges ahead for a public service broadcaster like RTE Radio, servicing a mass audience.
Well, where I come from in the US, public service broadcasting means the sort of programs that no one really wants to listen to, in terms of a mass market. Whereas here in Ireland, public service broadcasting seems to be defined by Radio 1 as the sort of programming that everyone wants to listen to. I think that suggests that something is missing in both cases, that the public service stations in America need to find ways of reaching a larger market, but also that Irish public service broadcasting should be thinking more strongly about catering to minority concerns and not just reaching 500,000 people on Morning Ireland.
Nowadays, those who emigrate to Britain have a pretty good chance of getting home should they wish to, but from America, obviously, it's a bit more difficult.
Bertie, you're very welcome. I was asking you, as the music was playing, about your own background.
Now, Amy Lorna takes you into the evening on Lyric FM, the ultimate classic.
13 years of age, on her Holliers and listening to the G. Ryan Show. And you're going to tell me what you
believe. RTE Radio is grappling with a declining share of the home market. This is inevitable in the face of increased competition. But it has a growing global market through satellite transmission on the web.
I left Ireland almost a year ago now, and we came travelling through Asia on our way here to Australia. Arrived in Sydney then about 7 months ago, so it's been a lot of fun then. But the hardest thing I think about travelling, despite the fact that you get to meet so many new people and so many different cultures and new friends, is being away from home and being away from your family and friends there. It's not like you can ring them up and say, hey, come on, let's go for a pint. It's kind of another continent away. But it's so much easier now to be able to stay in touch with home. Phone, text, email, I mean, every day you can be in touch. I can listen to Gerry Ryan when I come home in the evening, to cooking my dinner. It's really good, and it makes me feel a lot closer to home.
On Friday night, absolutely tremendous evening's entertainment. Fantastic.
Of course, the news, the political situation in Northern Ireland, the Nice Treaty. It's really good to be able to hear all these things. I don't feel like I'm missing out.
De Valera's dream of Ireland broadcasting its identity to the world may be about to be realised 60 years on, thanks to the new information technology.
And I think this was recognised by the founding fathers, and above all by Eamon de Valera himself. As he said in that opening broadcast, Ireland has much to seek from the rest of the world, yes indeed, and by God we're getting it now, but also much to give back in return. What do we give back in return if all we have to give is what we have received in and we're inundated by the stronger commercial powers? But I do believe that there's a capacity in this country in terms of public culture, in terms of which public service broadcasting is an integral part, to present a vital, an energetic, a growing, developing sense of Irishness, which adds to the totality of a European identity. And if we don't have it, frankly, what's the reason for existing? What's the reason for having an Ireland at all? Right?
For 75 years, the nation has debated its identity on RTE Radio. Whatever the future holds, it's a vital medium that will continue to contribute to our national evolution.
Radio Evans. This is the United States of America calling Ireland. I was
serious. Hello there.
Good morning, everybody.
This is Morning Ireland with David Hanley.
The chief items of tonight's news are...
It's 9 o'clock.
1972, that the great European powers are again at war.
He gets the topic right down, and it's the goal!
It took 115 years to make this trip.
So you had better do as you were told.
And three generations.
You better listen to the radio.
Good night, you all.
Good night.